I'm Michael Barron. I'm with the League of Women Voters, and I'd like to welcome you here this evening. This is a forum that we're doing in conjunction with Lakewood Library, and we appreciate all the help that they've given us. Tonight, our moderator is Jim McCarty, who's been a reporter at the Cleveland Plain Dealer for the past 25 years. For the past couple of years, he's been the PD's environmental reporter, and for 12 years, he wrote a weekly verdict column, Aerial View, which is now monthly?
Occasional.
Jim previously worked at the Miami Herald, Cincinnati Inquirer, Columbus Citizen Journal, and he lived for 14 years on Edgewater Drive, about 100 yards from Lake Erie. Now he resides in the Camp Corners neighborhood across from the Rocky River. Here's Jim.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, everyone. Good to see you all. It's a pleasure. My hometown, I mean, I grew up in Athens, but I've lived in Lakewood and the Camp Corners neighborhood for the past 25 years. And I think it's because of that, and not because I'm the environmental reporter, that I was most qualified to be the moderator of this event tonight. I think most of us here, I'd be surprised if anyone has not had firsthand experience with the wildlife in our neighborhoods. I'm a devoted vegetable and wildflower gardener, which puts me at the mercy of the wildlife, unless I outsmart them. I can't tell you the number of times I've chased deer out of my yard, or stuck a garden hose down a groundhog hole, or shooed rabbits out of my lettuce bed. So I wised up when I bought a new house 5 years ago, and with a big backyard. One of the first things I did was put up a 6-foot-tall wooden fence around the perimeter to keep the deer out, of course. Across the street from me is the Rocky River Reservation. And, of course, it's only effective when I remember to shut the gate. And when my next-door neighbor isn't replacing her side of the fence, which kept an opening there for 3 days, how did the deer know that they could get into my backyard garden during those 3 days and browse on everything in the garden? They are smarter than we can imagine. But deer are only part of the problems, obviously. Raccoons love to drink hummingbird nectar. Skunks love to dig up gardens and search of worms and grubs. And of course, bucks like my newly planted oak and tulip trees in the front yard, they use them as a rug for their velvet-colored antlers. And of course, they shred the bark in the process. So I've used my own techniques to deal with these wild things, but I'm not the expert. Here are the experts. Nearest to me, Jonathan Sepek, is a wildlife ecologist with the Cleveland Metro Parks. Some of you may have read his contributions to my setup story that appeared a few days ago in the Plain Dealer and on Cleveland.com. Next to him is Lisa Pettit. She's a chief of resource management at the Cauga Valley National Park, probably my favorite birding and hiking and biking jewel in northeast Ohio. And last but not least, the dean of naturalists in Cleveland, and a frequent contributor to the Plain Dealer and the radio station and television stations locally, Harvey Webster, director of wildlife resources at the Cleveland Museum of Natural History. Let's start with John. He's gonna kick things off with a PowerPoint and slideshow. Go ahead, John.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. I just really want to say this is really great. I appreciate sharing wildlife information. I'm a native of the area. I grew up in Medina County, and I studied coyotes when I was in graduate school at Cleveland State, and I have known the co-panelists for a few years, but I've never had an opportunity like this. One of the things that I was given 5 minutes, I'm going to have to be brief, to introduce kind of part of this topic. I went to school to study wildlife, not necessarily, can everyone hear me? Not necessarily urban areas or people, but I've learned in my career since the 90s that those are significant parts of this topic that we're going to talk about. I also get asked about, as a wildlife ecologist for the Cleveland Metro Parks, sometimes they're the residents' wildlife, and sometimes there are wildlife. And I get questions about what are the Metro Parks wildlife doing in my backyard? Or how are you influencing the things I want in my backyard? Well, let me preface this with, these are our wildlife. Wildlife are held in a public trust. They're a natural resource. They belong to all of us. And there's no logos on them, if I ever looked. So let me just open with, I think, in giving presentations. I'm going to cut a 45-minute presentation to 5 minutes to introduce the topic of urban wildlife and to share what I think are some critical components before we talk about a species or what we do to get more of it or less of it. I think it's important to understand some principles. We, humans, namely early settlers, have changed the landscape. This is what Ohio probably looked like at one time. 24 million acres of forest out of 28 million, 85% forested. Well, when we led the nation in the 1860s in wheat farming, 20 million acres of that had been cut down. That is a significant change from 20 million acres of forest lost, 4 million acres of forest left in our 28 million acres in Ohio. Significant change. We also removed predators. These are two examples. By the 1860s, cougars, wolves were gone, along with bison, elk, bears. By 1909, we did not have deer in the state of Ohio. The Cleveland Metro Parks is celebrating our 100-year anniversary. In the 60s was when the first time when somebody saw a deer in the Cleveland Metro Parks. Geese were also gone, along with many, many other species, but that's a longer presentation for another day. I have about 5 minutes. We then changed the landscape again at the turn of the 20th century through conservation laws, reforestation, and the other key component is that people started to move off of farms. Farms reverted back to fields. We had forest regeneration going on, and people began to move into the cities. Suburbanization expanded around our urban areas, not just in Ohio, but I'm talking specifically in Ohio. And when you divide that habitat up, you provide edge in a fragmented landscape, which deer love, edge. It provides an abundance of resources for some species. And let me go through that. It provides, actually, when we talk about the loss of species diversity in urban areas, sometimes what we don't talk about is the increase in abundance in certain generalist species in urban areas that have really adapted to some of these suburban situations. Wildlife needs, just Wildlife 101, food, water, cover, shelter, and space. Though we sometimes may think that wildlife adds emotion and the raccoon is out to get us, dumping our garbage cans or going into the garden, and sometimes I think that as well. I'm also a human beyond a scientist, that we wonder if the wildlife are malicious. But they really just follow their instincts. But we have to keep this in mind when we're asking, why do we have so many, or why do we have so few? Let's think about food sources. Sometimes when we have people with emotional attachments to wildlife, we feed wildlife, and we have intentional food sources that are provided, as witnessed in our park and along the lakefront. And if you feed a lot of bread on the right, you can bring in a lot of gulls. But please don't do it. There's a code against it in our parks. But sometimes we unintentionally feed them by the things that we do in our yard. Pet food, our garden. So remember the instincts when we think about why are they there. We kind of desolated Ohio by removing all this forest and habitat and removing species through market hunting and things. And then we suburbanize an area, put gardens, landscaping, and things like that, preferred habitat. And we also need to consider that we provide food sources sometimes year-round that don't naturally occur in the environment.
Yeah.
So this is where we balance. Do we want to see birds? Are we surprised when we see other things that are feeding on that food source or on the things that are feeding on the food source, doing direct with us? So when we look at this, we have to think that really, when we think sometimes there's a decline in habitat in urban areas, anthropogenically, people induced, we have a lot of food sources that are provided by people. Garbage, and not just garbage in your can. Take my kids to the park sometimes and you can see what they leave behind. I got a call in my former position about why are gulls at Cleveland Stadium, if you remember when the gull got hit by the baseball on TV. Because they didn't clean up at night. Now they clean up at night and brought the gulls into the empty section. But we're winning now, the stadium's full. So, gardens, pet food, bird feeders, supplemental, ornamental plants, highly productive lawns, open water in winter, year-round food sources, increase abundance in prey species, these small mammals, and things that other species eat, and roadkill. There's no shortage of free food laying on the side of our roads when we have these increased species. When we consider habitat, we do a great job sometimes with golf courses and other things and green lawns, but we also sometimes leave that water open through aeration, through warm water discharge, through just urbanization. Sometimes that water doesn't freeze. And it's very interesting to see what uses that. And it becomes so hospitable that geese sometimes don't migrate, and we have resident geese. So it shouldn't be a surprise when we look at just two examples, really, of the density. So in a rural area, it's been shown 3 to 14 raccoons per square kilometer is a normal population, let's call it. Suburban areas, 41 to 93. Urban areas, 37 to 73. And I found this today, so we see this. There have been recorded urban densities all over 300 raccoons per square kilometer on two separate occasions in urban areas. So these are other species that have been recorded that not, there may be less species diversity in an urban area, but there are higher densities, higher abundance of generalist species like this. Deer, raccoons, squirrels, coyotes, fox. Go sit in a park and look at how many squirrels there are, and then go down to Wayne National Forest and sit in the middle of the woods and see squirrels. So we also have an urban dimension to this. We offer things with bridges, rooftops, attics that offer additional space and another dimension that allow additional habitat on top of what would normally be there terrestrially. And gulls have figured this out in rooftops. So when we think, you know, why is a wild animal here or not here, we can flip it. They follow their instincts. Is there enough food for them to survive? And if they're there and you can't, and you don't know if there's enough food, there is a food source somewhere. Is there enough water? Is there enough habitat to find food in, sleep in, live in? Can it find a mate to follow its instincts to breed? If not, it's going to move somewhere else. Is there enough habitat to safely raise young? So when we see these species year-round, so those things determine the number of animals that can survive in an area. And if you have all this, you have wildlife. And with that, I'm probably over my 5 minutes.
Good job. Okay. Lisa Pett.
Hello, everyone. I'm going to parasitize off of what John just did. He's given you a great overview. And I was just going to add a little bit during my time initially to talk a little bit about the Cuyahoga Valley National Park and sort of what that situation is. As John pointed out, Ohio and most states really have gone through a period of development and sort of decimation of natural habitat, and then we bounce back as we create green spaces and parks and public areas that provide then habitat again for many of these wildlife species. But now we're integrated into these human population centers, so this is what creates this problem that John pointed out. Cleveland Metro Parks actually were established much earlier than the Cuyahoga Valley National Park. So in many respects, they were sort of more pristine in their situation when they were established. But Cuyahoga Valley, the boundary was drawn around existing population of humans. And then over time, over the 40 plus years that we've been in existence since 1974, we have been able to sort of bring back a natural condition within the park. So in some ways, we've improved the habitat. We've changed, we've reforested areas or brought them to natural meadows or wetlands. And so that has provided higher quality habitat than may have been there prior to. And we also, though, have a burgeoning human population around the edges of that park. So we have a lot of conflict that goes on in terms of nuisance animals, hazardous animals, and also public perception of risk associated with many of these animal populations that are that in some cases have increased within the park, but also have increased within that sea of human population around. And as John said, these are very generalized species anyway. So those are the ones that, because they can adapt to this fragmented situation or they can adapt to a high human population, they're the ones that actually thrive in this mixture of habitats that are here. So we, in the park, you know, of the list of species that have been mentioned already, I mean, the one that is most often a concern to the public is the coyote. And in many respects, it is a species that is just, because of its nocturnal habit, is just not well understood by humans. Often, you don't know that it's there until it kind of freaks you out when they start yipping in the backyard or something, and you suddenly hear them and it feels as though somehow this is not possible, that this type of animal exists in Northeast Ohio. And yet they've been here for many years. They're throughout the state of Ohio in every county. They have been in Northeast Ohio for how long, John?
Since the
90s. Since the 90s, and have increased almost exponentially for a while, and they are throughout every neighborhood, every suburban area, every urban area in Northeast Ohio, throughout Ohio, actually. And they're so secretive that, and really are avoiding you at every step, for the most part, that most people are just completely unaware that they are all around our homes all the time. Because they aren't really causing any trouble. And it only is when they become more obvious, or when they are coming to your food sources in your yard, that that's when we suddenly become aware of them. And it's interesting because they are a species that we react to kind of with fear or concern. And they're probably one of the least risky species around us. And, you know, it's interesting how people perceive risk and perceive, you know, how dangerous certain species are. And it's always interesting to me how people will react very negatively to the sight of a coyote. I get a lot of reports of seeing a coyote in the daytime, walking a ridge or something near where they live. And I'm always asking questions about what the behavior of the animal actually is. And, well, it's just walking. Well, it's just seems to be hunting. And but it shouldn't be out in the day. So there are a lot of myths associated with that, and we can get into that in more detail. And yet, the very large raccoon with all of its babies next to it crawling around on the front porch is not scary to most of the people. And to me, the raccoon provides a much greater risk of conflict, of potential bites or other negative interaction. But we have this sense of a raccoon as being a friendly creature. And I don't know if Disney did that to us or what, but so I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about what true risk there might be with some of these species that are, you know, occurring around us. The other issue that we encounter a lot at the national park is the love-hate relationship with beaver. They can be somewhat destructive. We've actually not had too many problems in recent years, but whereas they are actually creating incredibly wonderful habitat throughout the park, we usually let them do what they need to do. But sometimes they can be in conflict with homeowners nearby if they're causing dams of their water back up. But the biggest problem for us tends to be panic geese. And the issue that John raised about, you know, what, if there's food and protection from predators, and if they have a nice habitat, they're going to thrive in those areas. And we have created so many fantastic areas for Canada geese that they have actually lost their propensity to migrate. They do not very often migrate out of here, which they used to do, because they were in search of food or breeding areas. Now they have everything in one-stop shopping, right on our golf courses or at our little lakes in all of our developments, or places with nice slopes, grassy slopes down to a nice lake. Perfect situation for them where they can breed, find plenty of food year-round. The migration has changed. They don't need to leave to find food. And so that creates a relatively large problem, not just from an aesthetics or inconvenience perspective, but also, you know, they are actually polluting. They can cause high pollution levels within lakes. So the water quality is affected, as well as their conflict with other species can be problematic. So we have a variety of different ways that we view these species in terms of what their risk to us is or what their damage to the environment is. And it's really important to keep in mind what John said. What are the reasons behind their occurrence? Why are they here? And then also we have to remember, what is it that they are actually doing in the environment that might or might not be serious enough to try and manage it versus try to understand it and try to manage our own behavior, our own environment to help mitigate any of that conflict that might be happening. So those were some of the original observations I wanted to pass on. I've been with the National Park for 17 years as the chief, most recently as chief of the Resource Division. Had a long career with wildlife ecology and conservation. Not as directly involved with wildlife conflict as John has been over his career, but certainly have seen a lot at the National Park. We do have quite the microcosm of the world at that national park. So, and that's, I just introduce those issues and then we'll deal with questions, I guess, okay, later.
Thanks, Lisa. Harvey Webster from the Museum of Natural History.
What problems? there are some, you know, very, very serious conflicts with wildlife. However, my role as director of the Perkins Wildlife Center and Woods Garden at the museum, presented by KeyBank, is really to celebrate Ohio wildlife. And the fact is, as John pointed out in his introduction, and Lisa amplified on it, you know, 50, 60, 70 years ago, this was a different Ohio, not only in terms of the habitat, but also species composition, species abundance. It's interesting. I direct the Perkins Wildlife Center. Founded in 1970, its purpose was to have on the museum campus a display of living native animals that folks that live in the city or the suburbs might never see, like raccoons and white-tailed deer. And the premise, actually, at that point, is that these animals were absent from our urban and suburban areas, and we were worried that we would have a whole generation of people who would be reared up and not have any contact with our native wildlife resources. You know, nowadays, everyone's just on the, their cell phones or something, and they don't have that contact. But back then, it was the absence of the animals. So there have been extraordinary changes. Part of that's driven, as John said, by sprawl. Part of it's driven by extraordinarily adaptable animals that are taking advantage. They're taking a page from the human playbook. And that is, you know, they are adaptable. And they're generalists and they're doing quite well. When we talk about coyotes, I got to tell you my coyote story. So we have live coyotes on exhibit at the Cleveland Museum of Natural History. And we wanted to be able to display them precisely for the things that Lisa said. They are totally misunderstood. Everybody thinks that they're wolves. Everyone thinks that they're looming out there in the shadows. They're going to attack you. Are they a threat to you? No. Are they a threat to your cats and small dogs? Yes. Are they in your neighborhood? Absolutely. So you just need to be coyote smart. You can't do anything about excluding them necessarily from your neighborhood, but you can do really smart things. Keep your cats indoors. If you've got a small dog, make sure you walk it at night and you stay with it, and that way you offer the protection for those animals. Anyway, we were moving into this new facility, and we knew that we had this rather impressive enclosure where you step out of the museum, you're looking down two stories into this sort of ravine, and that's where we were going to put our coyotes. Now, as Lisa said, coyotes like to stay in the shadows. They don't like to show themselves. They don't necessarily like to broadcast their presence. So I was kind of desperate, like, well, what coyote can I possibly put in here? We hear about this story coming out of Texas, where a guy was driving down a highway north of Dallas one night. Coyote runs out in front of him. It's, so he's bummed about it. Pulls the car off the side of the road, gets out, happens to be a wildlife biologist. Takes a look at the coyote, she's dead. But her belly is swollen with pups, and the pups are moving. And being the son of a veterinarian and having assisted his father at doing emergency C-sections, he pulls his knife out and delivers four healthy pups on the side of a Texas highway. They were then taken to a wildlife rehabilitation center. They attempted to mainstream them with a bunch of other orphans for release. Didn't work out. They ended up being remarkably tame, and we got them. Now, when you see these animals, you know, we go to the railing, and John's seen them, and you look over the railing, and you yip at them, and all of a sudden, they're wagging their tails, and every desirable trait that you love in your dog is in that animal. So, I mean, it's the essence of the genus Canis is all there. They're wild animals. We're not trying to present them as pets or something other than what they are, but in terms of an animal that you have to respect those qualities. You can't just say, hey, you know, what I like in a dog is great, and those coyotes are just all evil things. So we just need to be able to understand them, and the more we understand them, then the more we can come up with ways to be able to coexist with them. And I think that that's, you know, the theme of tonight's presentation. I think it's a much richer world with all of the animals that we have around here. I mean, we can talk about how wise it was to breed Canada geese in captivity and release them, animals which would not have a migratory heritage, which was what exactly was done back in the 50s and the 60s, and then open water perpetuated their continued presence here year-round, and all of a sudden now we've got Canada geese everywhere. Fortunately, the comeback of the bald eagle is helping, because bald eagles sometimes kill Canada geese. So sometimes the more players we get, we're now seeing bobcat return to the state of Ohio. And I think that's exciting news. We get a neat medium-sized predator, and I think it creates more dynamic tension in ecosystems, and that might provide some sort of natural controls. With respect to deer, you know, my prediction, and I'm not really in these guys' business, but my prediction is 20, 30 years we'll see cougar in Ohio. Not because anyone put them here, but nature abhors a predatory vacuum. And someone's going to come along and fill it. The coyotes haven't filled it to the extent that they could. And so I think that there's an awful lot to celebrate about the wildlife diversity we have in the state of Ohio. If you come to the museum, I'll take you into the first gallery, Sears Hall. You look in the first glass-fronted cabinet. On the left, there's a brace of four passenger pigeons, and on the right there's a long Carolina parakeet. These are animals that used to be abundant. That's a passenger pigeon, perhaps one of the most abundant animals ever. Unfortunately, we destroyed their habitat and relentless market hunting. We caused their extermination before they had a chance to understand some of the dynamics about wildlife conservation and the need for habitat and safeguards. So I think we have much to celebrate. And then I think that there's a lot to be smart about in terms of, as we'll get into, you know, you got a garbage can, bungee cord doesn't cost you much to keep the top on the garbage can. You know, in Kirkland is where I live, and if I leave the bungee cord off, raccoons are in. I keep it on, they don't get in. If you've got a casual compost pile like I do, where I just put the kitchen scraps in the pile and just cover it with more soil, are wild animals going to go through it? Absolutely. Could I be inviting a bear to my yard? Well, a bear was in my yard 4 years ago. Didn't come for the compost pile, but it sauntered down Elm Street in Kirkland, stopped at the entrance of my driveway on Saturday morning, June 1st. It kind of didn't wave, but it was not unafraid of me, but not aggressive, because it was a male just kind of cruising the way males do. And that same animal, 2 days later, was over at, spotted on a security camera climbing over a fence into a parking lot at Lubrizol in Wigler. So those animals get along. Anyway, I think that there's always another way to look at it, that we sometimes want to have a hard dividing line between where nature ends and Jim McCarty's garden starts. But, you know, we do live in northeastern Ohio, and that idea of understanding the place where we live and the landscapes in which we live and have a better understanding of the ecology of the animals that are there, I think is important for them.
Thank you, Harp. The good questions are coming in. I have one that I wanted to get things rolling with. They say tall fences make good neighbors, but I'm not sure that applies when the residents on one side of the fence are using lethal pest extermination methods, and the residents on the other side of the fence have salt lick and are leaving plates of food out on the back step for their nightly visitors of like critters. How can everybody just get along?
Well, I'll just throw one thing out. Think hard and long about feeding any animal. You know, we love to feed birds because we have arbitrarily decided that that's a really desirable thing to do. But remember, you feed birds not because the birds need your food. You do so you attract them to your yard so you can enjoy them. And I guess we can get along with that. I would not feed any mammal because once you get a mammal established in a feeding station, it will come back. And if you do not feed it, it's going to tear your raccoons are going to tear your porch apart. It's best not to let those animals get habituated to an artificial feeding source.
The good questions are coming in, and they kind of dovetail right into some things that I'm interested about, because I don't know the answers. Can you legally shoot a bow and arrow in Lakewood? And while we're talking about bows and arrows, what about slingshots, BB guns?
Pellet guns? That would be a question for the city ordinance.
Are they different from city to city?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know about Lakewood.
No.
Probably not.
Probably no discharge.
Isn't Lakewood the most densely populated city between New York and Chicago? are there exceptions made for like bow and arrow and versus a slingshot? Or is a slingshot considered a lethal weapon? Or a BB gun?
That's above my pay grade. I know that. There are
are some communities that consider for advantage of deer that they allow archery. That there are some communities that allow hunting in general, but usually the more urban, smaller yards, they may consider archery or some joining of space by a cooperative, you know, cooperative effort through multiple backyards to archery safely from stand or shooting down. But each community is different. And when I used to work for the federal government in wildlife, human wildlife interactions, I would always say, here are the federal laws, here are the state laws, but you always have to check your local ordinances because they vary based on the composition and what's going on in the community.
Yeah, this here's one, there's a lot of coyote questions. Lakewood is like ground zero for problems with interaction between coyotes and pets and things like that. They weren't, I don't think I ever saw a coyote when I lived on Edgewater Drive, but apparently that's kind of the epicenter now of the problems. Are coyotes really the problem? They are supposed to be. How about people watching their pets? I mean, is it? I mean, I know there have been coyotes in Lakewood for many years, but why are they suddenly attacking dogs? This, here's somebody who's lived here for 25 years and never heard of an attack on a dog in Lakewood before. Things changing don't have enough rabbits and squirrels to eat, or
we've got a study where we monitor within the Cleveland Metro Parks where we monitor wildlife using cameras and to some extent public reports, and we're comparing the two currently in a research project. But what I can tell you with the reports that I get with the park. First off, I think based on where we see coyotes and we also see red fox and other species, I think right now we have plenty of resources to support both of those species in the area. If we didn't, you would see more competition, segregation, they would split up more, you know, it would be more territorial. So one, I think they've got enough to eat. I can't speak for each backyard, each community. I'm you know, living across 23,000 acres in the Cleveland Metro Parks. But generally, can that change? Yes. Talking about what coyotes eat, we did a study to verify that coyotes really don't rely on deer in our area. You can go to some parts of the country where they will reduce deer populations and keep them in check. I think if you look out your window or down the road, you can see we have plenty of deer. So there's not a whole lot keeping our deer in check. But coyotes don't really rely on deer here. They don't really pack up to take down deer here as they may in other areas or larger animals may, because they do have a lot to eat. When you look at the reports that I've got, I always look for an explanation. Because if you can't explain what's going on with that animal, what that interaction with a pet or a person, then it requires really some investigation. But I can tell you in every one that I've gotten a call from or I've investigated, there's two things involved. Somebody has attracted a coyote to their yard, or they have had a dog off leash that has either aggressively interacted with that animal. And let's face it, chihuahuas and small dogs will bark and try to bite me sometimes, and I'm a large mammal. So they're probably sometimes not, domestic animals may not be fearful. And the other thing with that is a small dog that runs in front of a coyote at night when coyotes are trying to avoid us may not look any different than a rabbit or a squirrel. So most of the reports that I've, well, all of the reports that I've been involved in, I guess, investigating and following up, that's what I've seen in my experience.
Don't they smell different? Don't rabbits and smaller animals smell, or isn't the scent different for a coyote?
I mean, in terms of
seeing versus scent, which is one of their specialties.
Well, the coyotes, most canids have a great sense of smell, but they also react to movement. And most coyotes that we've seen in our study them with wildlife cameras, they're avoiding people. When people are out, we've got cameras in an area where people are out, coyotes are avoiding them.
So
what I was getting to is they become what's called more crepuscular. They're out when people aren't, which is generally at night in our parks. And
and at night when something's moving and running in front of them, like a small dog on leash. You know, they may not rely on scent at that time, they're relying on movement.
And to get to also the question that was asked of, is there something different necessarily? If I recall what I learned about the incident in Lakewood, most recently was that one animal was removed, euthanized, and you haven't had the same, there have been no more attacks.
That's not true.
Well, in that location, I guess, but it may be that there are some animals that are adapted, again, acclimated to people, whether they were brought in because of food or whatever, they may be more acclimated, and so they're going to be a little bit more aggressive, either against the dogs or always against the dogs, really. It is really a territorial behavior more from the coyote's perspective. I think we've had one incident in the whole state ever that a human was bitten outright by a coyote, and that was a diseased coyote that was rabid at the time. And so they're almost always responding to the presence of dogs. And oftentimes we see the greatest number of aggressive behavior, a great amount of aggressive behavior by coyotes in the months of March to May, when they're actually denning and have young. And so they're very, very territorial. And when people encounter them and they're aggressive, they're usually unbeknownst to them. They've walked near a den site. And so, especially if they have a dog, and only really if they have a dog with them, have we ever seen in the national park that a coyote is aggressive to them. So it's really an individual thing, it's a spot thing, and you may never have additional problems once the animals are removed.
I thought Harvey has a colleague who's a friend of mine, Judy Semrock, who I think she told me about a study in which they studied the contents of the coyote stomachs, and I think it was mostly cat fur. I don't know if these are like strays. I don't know. It was probably a location of where it was, but wherever the study was done, that was they were eating cats.
Well, I don't know that study, John. Actually studied coyote diets in Northeast Ohio. We had another student from Cleveland State who also studied their diets. We had a number, actually, of students who studied that, and it's quite varied.
Yeah. Isn't that how you can tell coyote scat from the fur in the scat? Is that it, John?
When they're eating mammals, but yeah, you know, sometimes there are opportunities they eat insects. They're soft mast berries. I've got pictures of climbing apple trees to get the apples. In our area, we don't. Obviously, there have been incidents where we hear about pets being taken and pets being killed. Most studies show that coyotes don't kill pets as a food source. There are some areas, I'm sure, if there's not as much to eat, that may occur. But if you think about a cat, that cat's out, and we have pictures of them in our park, hunting small mammals. That cat is eating the pet food that's on the back deck, and that's direct competition for what the coyote's surviving on or have adapted to in backyards. So in my experience, in the studies I've seen, we're not relying on pets as a diet item in a normal, typical situation. So I'm not familiar with that.
We're getting a lot of questions about deer and the populations. How useful? I know that there was a culling this past winter in Rocky River Reservation and some of the other reservations. How effective are the birth control methods for deer used as a population control? Are the populations still growing, or have they leveled out? And are deer the ones who are transmitting a Lyme disease with ticks? Is that an Is that an issue in our area? I know, they're all deer related.
Do you want to take that contraception?
The science normally is there that if you have an animal at hand, I'm looking at science today, you can contracept anything if you have the animal at hand. The thing you have to consider, and I may look at this kind of practically, but though the Metro Parks has spent $500,000 on research looking at contraceptives in an older population, the studies you hear about with contraceptives, the key thing is to look at the number of deer they're doing and to look at where they're doing it at. Many times when you hear about contraceptives for deer, whether you're talking chemical or you're talking surgical sterilization, and the Metro Parks has done, or the National Park has done a great job referencing a lot of this in their documents, in their deer management documents. I think it's one of the greatest references out there, as is Cornell University's research looking at all the different ways to manage deer. The thing you have to consider with contraceptives is, number one, normally they're very costly, on average $1,000 an animal. Normally, you have to treat 85 to 90% of the population. So when we're looking across 23,000 acres of the Metro Park, or how many acres is that? 33,000 acres. That's a little bit different than an island or a fenced-in facility of a few thousand acres where you have a known number of animals that you can relatively easily get your hands on and mark and treat. But when you have to contracept 85 to 90% of a population at $1,000 an animal, and it's been done cheaper surgically with volunteer vets, but when you extrapolate that out to thousands of animals, they're free-ranging, and you put the time and effort into contracepting an animal, it can be done. I haven't even gone into the legal or permit aspects. That's something I'm skipping over to talk about kind of the practical application. Those animals free roam. And what's to stop new animals that aren't treated from walking in? What's to stop your treated animal from walking out? Does your neighbor want them treated? And when you're looking at this, and the other thing is when you're contracepting animals, you're coming to the table discussing a pretty serious situation where you have some effect, whether it's ethologically or your vehicle collisions or damage. You're then accepting a willingness to contracept something and keep it maintained in a population. And studies have also shown that if you contracept an animal that doesn't go through breeding processes or raising young, that animal is more fit, has a lot more energy to devote, and is less biologically stressed, and can live sometimes twice as long. So I look at it from a practical aspect, though we've done research on it, and I can give these references, but I look at it from the practical thing to say we have to go get our hands on 85 to 90% of the population if we can get the permit and the approval, which isn't there. And then you have to contracept that animal and most times retreat it or follow it. And then you have to contain it and keep the new ones from coming in. It's a tremendous amount of effort. So I guess some background information.
So they call the herds in the Metro Parks. Someone wants to know if you can call the coyote, trap them and take them away.
Well, John's going to be able to answer that one too. But conventional wisdom, and I guess practicality, is that it is very difficult to manage coyotes as a population or as a species in an area. And the most effective way to deal with problem coyotes is to deal with problem coyotes and remove individuals that have become acclimated to humans and are creating risk to humans or human or to pets, and remove those individuals. If you try to remove, I believe that if you try to remove large numbers of coyotes, they reproduce at a higher populate the area and move back in other individuals will. So it doesn't work as a management action.
I think if you look back and into what our government has done, or what is a society really, when we probably didn't value wildlife as much, or we thought that our resources were abundant. Let's face it, look at what we did to bison, but we still have them. But look at what, when wolves, bears, coyotes, cougars were, and sometimes persecuted, because if you were growing your own livestock and you didn't have hyenas and giant eagle, and you were relying on these animals, predators were viewed as a threat because they had a direct impact on your livestock. So at one time, our government tried to remove all predators. No holds barred. This was before EPA. This was before a lot of pesticide laws. And there was a lot of pretty severe methods that were done with that. Well, the point I'm making is we still have coyotes. We still have wolves. We still have bears. And these species are extremely adaptable. And it fascinates me, and sometimes it's frustrating. And a loss of pet can be a very emotional event because it's a family member. So that's where, if you have a coyote, so to say generally let's remove them because we're fearful of them and we don't like seeing them, I would say good luck, because it's been tried with gloves off and we still have them. So I think what you really need to do is go, what Lisa's saying is, if you have an animal that is a problem animal, that for whatever reason, you're not going to retrain it. It may be people that have induced it to come into backyards and take pets. Just seeing it doesn't mean it needs to be repeated. But based on the behavior, if that's truly the culprit, then that selective removal, you know, may occur. But to try to generally take out predators, which we're, you know, talking a different animal here, I don't think it's realistic, even if we thought it was a good idea.
There are deer deterrents out there, you know, products you can buy them at, you know, home and garden stores and Amazon and stuff. I know some people have used like hair, like dog hair, I think is one thing.
At one point, Irish Spring, shavings in a bag, or tankage, dried blood, or all those things have been offered up. The only problem is the animals get conditioned to the pet. There's no threat associated with it, and they
don't work out.
There are definitely things you can spray on the foliage that will make it unpalatable to deer. But just be mindful of the fact when it rains, you're going to have to reapply it.
Yeah, there's a peppermint deer spray that was recommended by your Kirtland neighbor, Hans Petrushka, to spray on the trees, and it seems to work, but and it's very it's not going to make anything sick. It just apparently they don't like the smell of peppermint. What about fox and coyote urine? Are those deterrents? No.
I work for the National Wildlife Research Center as a wildlife biologist. We tested a lot of means to repel wildlife or to scare them or ask them to keep them off of airports, for instance, where it's not good to mix wildlife and planes. That's obvious. We tested a lot of things, and I always attribute it to, you know, what Harry hardly said. I always said it's like a rubber snake. You know, you can throw a rubber snake down on April Fool's Day and maybe scare somebody, but sooner or later you step over it, you get used to it. It's the same thing with repellents and things, because there isn't anything behind it, because they're following their instincts. And when you're thinking about trying to find food or stab a cat or defend young, these things aren't going to keep them away. What you can think about is finding other things that around what you're trying to protect that maybe you're like and you're willing to give up. Because we do want wildlife. Surveys show we want wildness, and especially in the metro parks. And what happens is sometimes we try to control these animals. We want this, but we don't want that. We want this species, but we don't want it to do that. But when we begin to do that, it's no longer wild. It's domestic. So we have to think about, there's some things you can't control. You make the decision to tolerate it or to try and mitigate what's going on.
you know, with the old farmer's almanac to figure out what, how to handle the skunks that were rooting up my garden. And it worked. It was a mixture of castor oil, dish detergent, and water sprayed on the ground and in the, around the plants, but not on them. They stopped the...
Scared all the worms away, huh?
Yeah. Worms are non-native, I've heard.
That's right. Earthworms are.
Good work.
Let me actually add one thing to that, too. The other thing to think about is when you're going to, you're scaring something, you're asking or deterring it, you make it a week or something out of that repellent. But if it's a, if you're a sweet corn farmer and you're only worried about damage during the melt stage of sweet corn, that week of a repellent may buy you some time. And mixing some of these repellents and shiny ribbon and flashing lights up may buy you a few weeks, enough to get through tomato season. So it's not futile. You just have to realize that you will habituate to it. So you kind of have to mix it up a little bit with different things.
It's like the example sometimes with pest birds or other types of things, it was recommended a long time ago, buy one of these plastic great horned owls and put it out in your garden. And for a while, it has a repellent effect. There's a lot of animals that consider a great horned owl as a very significant predator, and, you know, they stay away. But then, you know, after a while, you know, again, the great horned owl doesn't seem to move much. And you know, I remember in one particular application, you know, the bird was actually standing on top of the head of the plastic great horned owl. So then they have bobblehead great horned owls, which, you know, can move around. That's kind of a cool thing. Or robotic great horned owls. But the idea is that, you know, even with something as ferocious a predator as a great horned owl, if the potential prey see that it's not moving from a particular space, you get accustomed to the rubber snake, as John said, and you know, it ceases to have the deterrent effect.
Lisa, do the Zelay corn growers still use those propane cannons down there for their fields?
Yes, they do.
And do those work? Keep the deer out?
Well, I think that they're most useful for the birds. I don't think they keep anything out except it just kind of annoys the residents and the trail users. But you know, they continue to use them, and I don't think that they have much luck. They also have quite a lot of hunting, removing of everything out of their.
And so they're
yeah, they're removing all the deer. And
their permits
and other wildlife, yes,
they
get damaged. So
yeah,
I think that's more of a deterrent than the cannons.
What do the laws say about, you know, trapping and shooting and things like that? I heard somewhere that coyotes are not protected, like, you know, they're not. Migratory birds, you know, that are protected, but what about, you know, deer and foxes and bears and things like that? I mean, does the law protect them from being shot or trapped or whatever?
So the references for generally it's a generalization, but the Fish and Wildlife Service has the responsibility to regulate, to oversee the public resource of migratory birds because they fly across state lines. You know, the Ohio Division of Wildlife, mammals, not that a deer stops in Indiana, but, you know, generally, the Division of Wildlife, turkeys are included because they're not a migratory bird, but they are the reference for the regulations on mammals. So, and the Ohio Division of Wildlife has a great reference on when you're dealing with wildlife in nuisance situations. Look up nuisance wildlife, and it'll tell you all the laws. Your Ohio Revised Code and the Ohio Administrative Code give you the regulations on what's protected, what you can trap, what you may need a permit for, why you shouldn't trap and relocate raccoons or fox or coyotes or things that can carry rabies and be moved across the state, because that's illegal. But that would be my suggestion to find the information on some
squirrels. So I used to, I had a have a hard trap, and I'd come home every day from work, and there'd be a squirrel in my have a hard.
take it down to the Metro Parks, did you?
I told you the story.
You have to have written permission from the landowner where you're taking squirrels, chipmunks, woodchucks, and moles.
I think the statute of limitations is passed. But what I did was I would, you know, the soccer fields, the ball fields down there in Rocky River?
That's where you're at.
Yeah.
Yeah, open it up, and they run. And I wish I had a camera. Two hawks came down and grabbed that squirrel and flew away with it.
Which is an interesting, you know, when people oftentimes, you know, say, I've got a nuisance animal, can it be just relocated somewhere else? Oftentimes, if you think you're doing a humane thing for that animal, oftentimes you are putting it in harm's way. It's out of its home territory. It's going to be, you know, disoriented, and it will be food. You will be feeding the hawks.
Yeah, I didn't know that was going to happen.
And I could clarify, but raccoon, skunk, beaver, coyote, fox, red or gray fox, and possum cannot be relocated because they can carry rabies and not show signs of it. So when there's a barrier, it keeps rabies from spreading into urban areas. So please don't bring those into the park and into the urban areas. The other species, squirrels, chipmunks, woodchucks, moles, under the Ohio law, I'm not the reference, I'm just referencing it, but you have to have written permission of where you're going to take it. Most of the time those laws are written for, you have something in your attic, you have a skunk under your porch. Doesn't mean you should take it somewhere else. It means that you can trap or relocate it on your property to then exclude that hole or the opening in the eave and keep it out. Just make sure there's no young in there before you close it up. So it's meant to on your property. You can relocate it on your own property and just keep it out of where you're trying to.
A long, long time ago, the Museum of Natural History had a wildlife rehabilitation program back in the 70s and 80s, or actually the first time in this region. And we would accept orphan animals, and I think the year was 1980, and we had something like 60 raccoons, baby raccoons that were brought to us. And you know, they were all coming from these animal control agencies that were, you know, going, and they would say, you got a problem animal, they'd set their trap, they'd take the animal, they'd relocate it, who knows where they relocated them. They never looked under the trap to find out if there was a nursing female and whether she had young, and so all of a sudden they've got these youngsters that are, they have to go back and return to. But there was, I sort of thought at the time what they would do is they would charge a rather substantial fee for trapping an animal, and then I got that sense that they would go right around the block and let it go, so it would return right back to where it had been a nuisance, so they'd have to be engaged yet again with the same animal. So. Curious kinds
back there. Yeah, here's a good one. Are wild turkeys becoming a problem? I know we've had them walk, they find their way to Edgewater Drive and Lakewood occasionally. I think one spent like an entire winter over there on Lewis Drive in Lakewood a couple years ago. Are they? I know their numbers are growing. Are they? Are they a problem, or people just like turkeys in the
neighborhood? We are seeing. If you've seen a few years ago in downtown Boston with the issues with traffic, when turkeys, wild turkeys, were being had to be escorted by police across the streets because they were holding up traffic. So they have another species that have adapted to urban areas because again. We have backyards with food. It's a safe, quiet backyard. That's what we want for our kids. We want safe and quiet for them. It's little risk of starvation or predation. They raise young, but have learned then to live in these backyards, just like deer and these other species we talk about. Voila, we have turkeys that are surviving and making it in urban areas, and we're seeing populations grow. Are they a problem? I think if you had 30 on your roof and they're scratching on your shingles, that may be an issue. But
has that happened that you know of?
I had a complaint when I worked with the federal government about I may have just been 30 turkeys on the roof. But what was interesting was when we went out to look at them, they had white. They weren't completely dark turkeys with natural coloring. So somewhere in there, and that's the other thing that we're used with people.
You do hear sometimes of a turkey. I remember this happened in Kirkville in Lake County. And I was driving down Baldwin Road, this sort of country lane right by the local chapel. And there is the gentleman from the Kirkwindville Service Department. He's in his truck. He's got the windows rolled up halfway, and he's looking down at something. And then there's the Kirkland Hills patrol car on the other side, and the officer has just stepped up, and he's got his hand on his service revolver. And I'm like, gosh, what's going on up here? And I come around the corner, and here's this Tom truck, and it's attacking the hubcaps of the truck. And he was attracted by the shiny, they weren't all that mirror-like, but something about them. And they'd be pecking at the hubcaps, and every time the guy would hit the horn, then the turkey would gobble. And then they got out, and you know, I joined the policeman, and we started chasing him, and he'd go around to the other side of the truck, and he'd do the same thing there. And it took about 15 minutes to sort of shoo him off into the underbrush. So everybody leaves, and as I'm taking off about maybe 100 yards down the road, I look in the rearview mirror, and another car's come around the corner, and the turkey comes right back out. I'm sure it gets flattened, but I heard of one in Cleveland Heights, and I'm not with the King Jr. Drive in the city of Cleveland. Similar types of things, very bold, and oftentimes with a very curious, perhaps fatal attraction to hubcaps.
And we had a case of two Tom turkeys who were in collusion on the towpath trail attacking bikers as they went by, and the rangers termed them Beavis and Butthead, and they were removed and sent to another place.
Good.
Farm.
So turkeys are, I guess, wouldn't you consider them a success story? I mean, they were extirpated, I think, 100 years ago in Ohio, and they're reintroduced. That was a program, right?
Yeah, unlike the coyotes that everybody says were reintroduced into the Cuyahoga Valley National Park, they weren't, but turkeys were.
Yeah, so that's a success story. Peregrine falcons were reintroduced. I don't know. I would consider peregrines a nuisance, but they people are asking about success stories of reintroduction. You mentioned Canada geese. I mean, I remember the first deer I ever saw in Ohio was a buck crossing the road in front of our school bus in high school, Northampton Township. You didn't see him, and now I guess we were too successful, maybe with Canada geese and deer and things like that.
Whether it's too successful or we didn't count on how adaptable these animals would be. And everybody always thought with deer, for instance, I won't speak for the Division of Wildlife, but when they were managing a resource statewide, and it was in the state population was still in, let's say, the tens of thousands, these were animals that were in rural areas or state forests or places where you could apply traditional wildlife management techniques. You could estimate how many you wanted to remove from the population. You could set a season. You could let hunters go and do that work. But, once they get into your metro parks and once they get into a suburban backyard, then those traditional techniques are all of a sudden off the table. And if you are going to shoot them, or if you're going to use lethal force, then it's got to be a culling situation, highly controlled, expensive. It gets to be a real operation. And, you've still got all of those suburban backyards, which are a huge reservoir or pool of deer. They can just immediately move back into those spaces. And so it becomes a really thorny issue. Issue which both agencies here are dealing with admirably.
And it is success stories. As much as you may be frustrated by the number of deer or the number of geese, as Harvey mentioned, the passenger pigeon, the most abundant bird in North America, we didn't take care of it. It was gone. And so I can't imagine, even when I have frustrations with geese and the call we get on the lakefront, normally attributed to people feeding and attracting large numbers of them, but I can't imagine in the fall not hearing geese honking in a V. Those are migratory. We had a meeting, so that's good. But or imagine seeing a deer. So there's a great book called Nature Wars, and it's talked about that, as a culture we have all these resources and we took them for granted. until they started disappearing. And then we became conservation-minded and put wildlife and natural resources protection laws in place. And we've done such a good job with a species that maybe we didn't predict how adaptable and how smart they would be to survive. That's all they're doing. And we have an abundance. And what we now have as a culture, we risk that every bit of wildlife in an urban area becomes a nuisance and a pest. And we risk devaluating it all again for people that really don't go out as much as they used to culturally and aren't out in nature, that we devalue it if we don't learn to understand it and figure out some of these problems. And culturally, we've domesticated food sources so much that we have stopped hunting. But there are movements, and we had a speaker that was a vegan for years that decided he wanted to know where his food came from. And he saw this abundance of species, and through a locavore movement, he decided to start hunting because he wanted to know where his food came from. And instead of these animals, you know, looking at it as a resource, he started mushrooms, and it was an amazing story. And now he hunts turkey, deer, and geese, these things we have in abundance, because he wants to know where his food came from. But our culture has changed, and the country's most advanced is probably not.
There's a question, and I second this question. Is it our imagination, or are there more turkey vultures around these days?
I think there's a lot more turkey vultures, or I should say turkey vultures are also becoming habituated to urban and suburban habitats, and they're finding lots of great opportunities to be able to exploit. And a couple of years ago, I called over to Brattenhall Place, and it was interesting to see the folks that had the really fancy penthouse on the building closest to Lake Erie. We were a little bit dismayed that the local turkey vulture was roosting on their penthouse balcony railing. It's kind of like, what do they know that I don't? Has my time come? I think it's another example of a very adaptable species that's finding opportunities in our city.
Yeah, I know they're all over Rocky River Reservation, and I know they roost in downtown Brecksville. Mm-hmm. And there's some black vultures mixed in, which is just kind of unusual. How about wildlife rehab centers? Any chance for Harvey? You said the museum used to do rehab, but I know there's the Lake Erie Nature Center that does bird and wildlife rehab. Is that something that has any chance of a larger or more varied type of wildlife rehab centers popping up?
We've got some great ones. Lake Erie Nature and Science Center, Bay Village, Lake Metro Parks at the Clinton Wildlife Center, and the Dino Raptor Center. It's a really, really fine organizations. And, they are taking injured and orphaned animals, but on that orphaned part, most times when people encounter young animals, they assume that they're orphaned and they really are not. So one of the things that these agencies do is they sometimes provide a great clearinghouse of information. You don't just show up with the animal, call them first, and they can perhaps talk you out of intervening. But if you have an animal that is injured, you've got a hawk with a broken wing or something of that sort, they're there. And I got to give a shout out to the folks at Lake Erie Nature and Science Center, because this last spring, Tim Jasinski and Amy Lamons of their staff orchestrated a great monitoring program of the effects of our lit buildings in downtown Cleveland. And they saved and were able to release 93 birds that had smashed into all of the iconic glassy buildings in downtown Cleveland. Unfortunately, there are hundreds and hundreds of specimens that did not survive that will now live, if you can call it that, in museum collection drawers. But they're documenting the impact of our downtown buildings, both glass and light, on migratory birds as they come through town. So really, really important resources. Some good science will come out of that. And hopefully will help us in the effort to get building owners to turn their lights off and embrace practices that are much safer for birds.
I, speaking of Tim and the Lake Erie Center, I think there's a training session that he's going to be holding.
Next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday, yeah. And I'm going to do a story about it eventually, but probably once the migration starts and they're down there picking up birds off the sidewalks and rescuing birds and stuff, I'll write something.
Yeah, we've been at this effort for a long time. We started out a program called Smart Light, Safe Light, because people didn't like the sound of lights out Cleveland. The fact is, Lights Out Cleveland, the Lights Out program is gaining traction in cities across the United States, starting in Toronto and then Chicago and New York City, and the Ohio Bird Conservation Initiative is taking the lead with the Ohio Lights Out program. So under that common banner, there's two components. One is, let's start the monitoring to find out just what is the impact, and then use that to work proactively with the building owners that, you know, turn your lights off. This is a win-win. You save money, you save energy, you save birds, and you promote an environmentally friendly image to the city. So we're hoping we'll gain traction this fall.
Yeah, that's a great program. And there are some brochures from the Lake Erie Science and Nature Center back there that you can pick up on your way out. Here's a something I also second, I wonder about this. How, if in any way, will global warming, climate change, impact wildlife populations in our region?
I'll take a stab at that one. For the most part, I guess it would be one generalization is that we have changes in the plants that will inhabit this location over time, with more southern species of plants coming to this area. And so you will see a change in the wildlife that are associated with those plant communities, potentially. But I would also say that I think you could generalize that these types of species we're talking about that are very adaptable to the human environment will only thrive more under situations where climate change has perhaps changed the natural environment away from their usual habitat. They will become more adapted to what humans provide. And they're generalists anyway, so that they can thrive under a whole broad array of environmental conditions. So I think these same species are going to do well under all scenarios going forward.
Is there any explanation for the increase in bobcats in Ohio? Is that climate-related, or is that prey-related, or what is that?
Well, my understanding is that we have animals that are coming in from neighboring states, and we've got wonderfully suitable habitat that's just waiting to receive them. And again, I think it's a welcome addition.
And bear, too. I don't know why a bear would want to leave Pennsylvania, but they're kind of wandering into our area. I wonder how long it will take till they reach Cleveland Heights and Shaker Heights.
I think they have.
They have.
Really? That doesn't mean that they're dwelling permanently there, but you know, these males, they undergo their walkabouts, and they can go dozens, if not hundreds, of miles. And they can, the one that I saw, in my front yard, was definitely one that, who knows if it hailed from Pennsylvania or if it hailed from Trumbull County, but it was on a little walkabout looking for territory, looking for female, looking for resources, and that's pretty typical of them.
Yeah, I think bears have been wandering through at least in 15 years or so, have been wandering through our areas, but they have a habitat, or they have to stay, versus bobcats that are expanding, and we've seen the declining gray fox across the state, but bobcat are doing well, as mountain lions, as you mentioned, are expanding their range across our country.
Well, I don't know if we'll see gray wolves in our time in Ohio, but Harvey says we're going to see cougars. That's something to look forward to.
Well, let me just explain that. I mean,
they'll take down the deer population.
Well, all I base it on is the fact that mountain lion populations are expanding. They're expanding in the West. You know, they've turned up in some neighboring states, and you could easily see. I mean, if you take a look at how people coexist with cougar out in Los Angeles and places like that. Yes, occasionally there is a negative interaction, but considering the population, the huge numbers of people, it's really surprisingly infrequent. And again, I think that there is a huge opportunity for an animal like that, a large predator, to move in the state and start eating lots of deer. And that might not be a bad thing. You know, I think everyone has probably seen the TED video that talks about the reintroduction of wolves to Yellowstone and this trophic cascade, predatory cascade, where in the absence of wolves, the elk had mowed down all of the riparian habitat and had fundamentally changed the look of a lot of the habitats in Yellowstone. You reintroduce wolves, the wolves start hunting the elk cannot be out in the open with impunity anymore. They have to stay back in the forest. It changes their grazing or their browsing habits that allows the restoration of vegetation along the streams and rivers, that allows a lot of the other organisms to come back there. And basically, it seems to be good for biodiversity. And we can go through our forests around here, and John and Lisa can speak to this, and in areas where we do have too many deer, you can see basically a browse line established, and those forests have been over-browsed, over-grazed, and you don't see the kinds of spring ephemeral wildflowers anymore. We have too many deer in those habitats, and that's bad for biodiversity. So we need to have some way of being able to do the best job we can in terms of managing for all the species.
Somebody asked, if you have any recommendations for perennial flowers that deer just don't like. I don't think they like purple cone flowers. The kind of spiky tops and
so scratch the tulips off the list.
Oh, tulips are number one on the list. Yeah, and I know they like trillium. Set your spring.
A lot of spring things. They don't like daffodils.
No, daffodils. That's a good one.
Some of it is also. I've asked you talked of what are deer resistant plants, and you can look, and there are things that completely contradict one another. You have to take that into context. And the best explanation I've ever heard is it's called the refrigerator effect. So if I'm hungry, I'm going to the refrigerator, and I'm going to get the good stuff first, or my kids will. My teenage son will die. Sooner or later, you go for what the leftovers or the things in the back that aren't as appealing. And so it's all a matter of context on what's there. Because I've seen things that swear that deer won't eat it. But deer are also browsers, so they just kind of walk along and munch as they go. And sometimes even the things they don't like, they take a few bites of it as they go. Stinging nettles. Look at some of the things that deer eat, greenbrier, things like this. You know, these are not what would appear appealing. So it's worth taking a look at the literature to see and kind of see if there's patterns in it. But you also have to realize what is that compared to. And if you're starving, or you're following your instincts, and they eat everything, even what's in the back of the refrigerator.
I think we're wrapping up, Mike. I have a stack here. I hope I didn't miss anyone's questions. Anybody have a burning question that I didn't get to? Over here.
Yes, with climate change, I was wondering, we have Lyme disease moving in from the east, and we have some other diseases moving up from the south, and does climate change have any effect on that, or is that just other things at work?
I believe there is has been shown that climate change is having some effect on the prevalence of ticks, their ability to over winter essentially, and to expand. And so unfortunately, I have to come into this area. It used to be so nice in Northeast Ohio.
Tick free, it seems.
And there's definitely an impact of climate on their resiliency and the ability to overwinter. So, and we have a number of pests that are coming into, or sweeping across the country, really, and driven often by climate change, or assisted by climate change.
Yeah, I've had at least 15 ticks this year so far.
Yeah. I don't know whether this is on subject. We've got 5 bird feeders out. Now, I'm an animal lover. I think it's wonderful when I see the deer come by. I don't mind the deer eating my shrubs. The only thing I'm having a problem with is the deers are going after my bird feeders. And I'm afraid to put anything on, like squirrel waste, on the seed, because we want the chipmunks and the squirrels and the other creatures that eat what falls on the ground to eat it. So I wonder if anybody has any idea what I can do to discourage the deer from going after my black sunflower oil seed.
Put them on fire.
This is, John laid this out, I think, very effectively earlier. It's just this is, how you want to feed some of the animals, but not all the animals. If you put it out there, it's a smorgasbord for whoever comes in. It's really, really difficult to say, no, you're not invited to that party. And, because even if you have, put a higher pole, you're going to still have seed scattering in the ground, you still have,
I had questions when I was with the federal government to ask if we could give permits to remove hawks because they were killing birds on bird feeders.
Right.
Hawks need to eat too, and you're attracting the species that they're preying on. So, there are these indirect effects that you get, as Harvey said. I don't recommend feeding any wildlife because you're influencing their behavior.
I think.
Yeah. But I also understand, I at least can respect that. Be in touch sometimes with outdoors, that bird feeding allows you to see nature. But you just have to remember, you're putting something out that they need. Yeah.
All right, last question.
Are we kind of writing on a note of hope? Is there any?
Oh, sure.
Is there any hope?
Well, I guess, elaborate hope for what? I think that this is sort of a golden age of wildlife, and that we've got so much wildlife that's sharing this part of the world with us. And I think that is, all of us are concerned about a lot of the other species that are not generalists that, are suffering because of things like climate change or because of shrinking habitat or because of invasive species, and they don't have any mechanism for dealing with that. But I think it's extraordinary. Again, we touched on things like the bison and the pasture ridge a couple times, but that was ground zero for conservation. And we have come a long way, baby, since 1900 when, there was hardly any forest in Ohio, and even something like a raccoon would have been an unusual animal to encounter. So, I think that if you enjoy wildlife and wild places, there's an awful lot to enjoy these days.
I think there's hope because you're all here. I said when I started in the 90s, that in the late 90s, I thought it was about wildlife. What it's about is people understanding wildlife and understanding why they're there. If we're going to conserve them, if we're going to help threatened and endangered species, if we're going to deal with wildlife that truly selectively cause issues, it all comes down to what people add to these instincts we put up there. People add emotion. And that influences our decision. So what's hope, I think, is based on is people understanding it and making science-based decisions for this. We appreciate wildlife and acknowledge the emotion, but we really have to look at the science and why wildlife are there and they're not. And that's what we have to make our votes, our funding, our efforts on. So I think there's hope, because it is. There's a lot of great things going on. Even for those nuisance coyotes, they're amazing creatures that have adapted.
Thank you, Jonathan. I like the wildlife there, and I like the people.
Thank you for being a great panelist.